Welcome to my dear student. Today I am going to start a topic called basic model of computation. This is the first topic of first unit of computer programming through C. So in the first unit, the unit name is Introduction to Programming. In first unit, I am covering today first lecture. In the first lecture, the heading is Basic Model of Computation. So dear student, I started here first unit. The first unit of computer programming through C. The first unit name is Introduction to Programming. In the first unit, the first lecture is Basic Model of Computation. So we are going to be start. So this is the content of the lecture. So today I am going to be cover this all topic. The first we are going to be talk on computational model. Next we are going to be see random access machine. We already know about random access memory, but here we are going to see about random access machine, and finally we are also going to see the difference between random access machine and random access memory. And the last we have to talk on von Neumann model of a computer, that is called stored program model. So we will see one by one here. So now computational model. So in this computational model, we have some points. We will see one by one all the points. The first point says that computational model is a mathematical model in computational science, which require extensive computational resource, which help us to study about the behavior of a complex system by computer simulation. So it helps about the behavior of a complex system by computer simulation. Second point says that computational model is the common basis of programming language and computer architecture. The third point says that it provides higher level of abstraction than the programming language and architecture. And the fourth point says that computational model is the combination of programming language and the architecture. So these four points covered comes under the computational model. The next we have other two points of the computational model. The fifth point talks about the algorithm. So algorithm is one of the base for any programming language. If you know how to write the algorithm, you are able to be know how to write the program code, source code. So algorithm should be language and machine independent. Dear students, please note it here. Our algorithm should be language independent as well as machine independent. So we can write our algorithm in such a way so that our algorithm should be language independent and as well as machine independent. For example, I have given an assignment to write algorithm about addition of any two number. Then you have written step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, and you have given to your programmer to just code it and execute. But this algorithm should be, maybe the one programmer work with the C language, maybe the other programmer work with the Java and C sharp or C++. So algorithm should be performed independently. It should be not depend on any particular language. Fifth point is cover about the algorithm. And the sixth point says that then how we are going to be know about the efficiency of algorithm and how we are going to be measure the capacity or capability of the algorithm. So we have a two way to know the efficiency of any algorithm. So we have a two important tools. First one is called random access machine model of computation. This model will help us to measure the efficiency of an algorithm. And second one is asymptotic analysis of worst case complexity. So we have a three types of a cases: worst case, best case, and average case. So asymptotic analysis talks on the worst case complexity. So these are the two important tools by which we are able to measure the efficiency of an algorithm. Next, we have random access machine model. Dear student, please don't be confused. Here I am going to talking for the random access machine, not a memory. So inside the random access machine, we have few points we will see one by one. So first point says that an idealized notion of how the computer works. So random access machine model explains how the computer works, and it also explains about the operation. So we have a many arithmetical operation like addition, subtraction, equal sign, multiplication, and conditional statement like if and switch and for loop. This all comes under the conditional statements, and this always take exactly one step. That means our memory will be accessed step by step. That means our memory will be accessed each data step by step. So that it's mentioned each one step exactly. Loops and method calls are not simple operation, but depend upon the size of data and the content of the method. Dear students, here mention that loops and method is not simple operation, but it's totally depends upon the size of the input data. Measure the runtime of an algorithm by counting the number of steps. So if you want to know the runtime complexity of any algorithm, then we have to count the number of steps. That means number of iteration which is performed by the algorithm. So program for a RAM is not stored in memory. That means here RAM is not like a random access memory. Here RAM is a random access machine. So thus we are assume that the program does not modify itself. So this is all about the random access machine model. Now here we can see this is the exact image of the random access machine. And random access machine consists of some following points we will see one by one. So random access machine consists of fixed program. That means a program should be fixed. Second point is that it consists the unbounded memory. The bounded memory and unbounded memory. That means memory should be not bounded. It's unbounded. Third point says that it's a read-only input tape. And fourth point says that write-only output tape. So input tape and output tape. Input tape means through which we are able to give the instruction to the computer. And output tape means that is the result which we are getting from the system. Each memory register can hold an arbitrary integers. That means a number of integers can be held by each memory registers. Here integer is a data type. So please don't confuse. Integer is a data type. Maybe integer here data type is an integer. Maybe it's float. Maybe character. Maybe string will be there. So each tape shell can hold a single symbol from a finite alphabets. Here the word I use finite. That means a fixed alphabets. So these are the following points which consist random access machine, and this is the diagram which helps you to give a exact or clear view about the random access machine. Here see, it's an input tape. This is known as an output tape. Here is the program which is performing, and this is the part of the memory. So input through which we are getting like a keyboard or mouse, through which we are giving the instruction to the memory, to the computer, and then finally the program will be executed based on our instruction, and then we will get finally output. Next, we are talking for the space complexity. A space complexity is totally talking about the amount of space required by the algorithm to run for its completion. That means amount of space required by the any particular algorithm to perform its function or to complete its performance. So amount of space required by any algorithm to complete its function is called space complexity of the particular algorithm. For example, I have given a question, write a algorithm to perform two addition of a two number. Then we have written our algorithm, but this algorithm, how much space is going to be occupied in the memory till the execution? So that is the space complexity of the particular algorithm. So now here we have a two part. One is called fixed part and another is called variable part. Fixed part means what? That memory is already fixed. For example, in C programming, we have four types of a data type, like date, integer, float, character, string. So each data type having a fixed memory. For example, integer can occupy 2 bytes and float can occupy 4 bytes. So I have considered int a. A is a variable which occupy 2 bytes in the memory. But same way, if I consider a data type float and the variable name is b, then this b occupy 4 bytes in the memory, because this integer and float data types already defined in C programming language, and that can be its inbuilt. So integer will be occupied 2 bytes and float will be occupied 4 bytes. That means it's a fixed. It's a by default they will be occupied this amount of memory. But in the case of a variable part, for example, array, it's a dynamic array. Array name is a. Here it's a variable. If the size of the array is 5, then it occupies 5. If the size of the array is 10, then it occupies 10. That means the a is variable name, but we have given here a is what, which type of a data type. If I have given a is an integer data type and you have given the size of the array is 5 here, then 5 into 2, how much it become? 10 bytes it will be occupied. So it's a variable part. So it says that a space needed by variable whose size is dependent on the size of the problem. That means the size is not defined. That means the size is not independent. It is totally depend on the size of the problem. That is the case of the variable part. And this how it's different from fixed part and the variable part. I hope it is clear for you. This is the same. I try to explain you with the help of example how the space complexity will be considered or con. For example, let us consider example void float sum. So here data type is float. So float is 4 bytes occupying. Sum is our variable name. So float multiplied with a. A is again variable name. And again here integer is a data type and n is a variable name. So here two data types I use, float and integer. It's a data type. And two variable I use, this is a and this is n. Now float s. So s is a which type of a data type? Float data type. And s is a variable whose initial value is 0. Now for loop I have taken. So integer I equal to 0, I less than n, and I plus plus. That means the for loop will be start from 0, it will be go till less than n, and it will be incremented one step. So this is the exact format of the for loop. When we are going to use the for loop, we have to use this syntax. So I equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus. That is called increment value here. So suppose example the value of n equal to 5 here, then how much this loop will be work? So it will be go till 5 here. N is the 5, so I will be go till n less than 5, that means it will be go till 4. Please try to understand here. If I am giving the n equal to 5, then for loop will be how long it will be work? I equal to less than 5, that means till 4 it will be go. So s value is added after each iteration and I value will be also added here. So initially I will be here 0, then again the second iteration I will become 1, then 2, then 3, then 4. So 4 is the last element here. Why? Because I am taking the n equal to 5, so I value should be less than 5, so it will be go for till 4 and it's started from 0, so return s. So this is the simple program I try to explain you to make you how the space complexity consider. So a space complexity here it's a variable part. It's a variable part because why? Because we didn't define the value of n. Once we define the value of n, then it comes under the what? Fixed part. It's a here we without defining the value of n, it's a variable part. But once we define the value of n, it become a fixed part. Next, we are going to see the running time of algorithm. So how we are going to be calculate the running time of any algorithm? So it depends upon input size. So first point says that any algorithm runtime, if you want to be calculate for any algorithm, then we have to first try to know about the input size, the value of n, then size of an array. So next we are going to be know the size of an array. The last slide already I told you the size of the array and value of n. So I have considered there n equal to 5, then size of the array become 5. Next, third point says that polynomial degree, an element in the matrix. Here again, here matrix is nothing but it talks about the two-dimensional array. So in a C programming language, two-dimensional array is also known as a matrix. So bits in the binary representation of input vertex and edges in a graph. Then finally we count the number of primitive operations performed. So how many primitive operations are performed here? If you want to be calculate the runtime of a algorithm. So we have a two types of operation, primitive operation and non-primitive operation. So primitive operation is nothing but it's just like a pseudocode. It's identified the pseudocode. Again here the word comes here pseudocode. Pseudocode means what? Pseudocode means it's a just like algorithm. But again it's a long difference between pseudocode and algorithm. Algorithm is a well defined step by step procedure, but pseudocode is a normal English sentence. In a simple way we can say that pseudocode nothing but it's a normal English sentence which can be understand by any literate person. But algorithm means it's a well-defined step-by-step procedure that can helps the programmer to write a source code for any complex problem. Now a step to determine the time complexity. We have following steps. So each step we are going to see, and by that we are able to know how to determine the time complexity. The first step says that determine how you will measure input size. First step, how you will measure input size. The first we are going to be measure the input size. Second, we are going to be choose the type of operation, which type of operation we are going to perform, like addition operation, arithmetical operation, or swapping or comparison operation. So first step, we determine the size of the input. Second step, we choose the operation types. That means which type of operation we are going to be used. Arithmetical operation, a swapping, or comparison. Third step says that decide whether you wish to count operation in a three cases we have. Decide. In the third step, we have to decide which cases we are going to perform our algorithm or our problems or operations. So best case is there, worst case is there, average case is there. So these are the three basic cases. Now we have to decide under which cases we are going to perform our operation, because each these cases having different time complexity. Best case means best option, immediately you will get it. That means fewest possible operation. Worst means it's really difficult, it will take more time to perform the operation. Average means not more, not less. That is average case. So in the fourth step says that for the algorithm and the chosen case, express the quant as a function of the input size of the problem. As I told you in the first step itself, if you want to measure the time complexity of an AI algorithm, then we have to first determine or measure the or try to know about the size of the input. Now we have a primitive operations in an algorithm. So what are the primitive operations? So we have a primitive operations means some of the following points are there. Assign a value to the variable. We are going to be assign the value to a variable. For example, A is a variable. So value A is, I'm assigning 5. Now A is carrying 5 value. Then call a method. Again, it's a function call. Arithmetical operations. We have many arithmetical operations like division, multiplication, addition, subtraction. So here A multiplied in B. Again here A minus B multiplied C. So these are the example I have given. Comprising two numbers. Now we are going to compare the two numbers. So these are the sign of the comparison. A less than equal to B, A greater than B, and A greater than C. So these are the comparison symbols. Indexing into an array. So we are going to be give index to an array. For example, A of 0 equal to 5. That means the first element of an array having 5 value. So index. So array having first index value is 0. So array should be always starting from 0 index. So that is the, it's a defined, we cannot change it. So first index value of an array is 0 and that equal to 5 here. I hope it is clear for you. Now we are going to say about the for loop. So for loop is again conditional statement. It is one of the important loop. Here we are going to see, try to understand it with the help of example. So here for, it's a syntax of the for loop. For I equal to 0, I less than equal to n minus 1, I plus plus. Here increment value is there. Here comparison value is there. Here assignment value is there. So here I equal to 0, I less than or equal to n minus 1, I plus plus here. So now here we are going to see the runtime of a for loop. Here we are going to see the runtime of a for loop. How we are going to be calculate the runtime of a for loop? We are going to be calculate totally based on the value of n. Totally based on the value of n. Because this loop will be continue till n times. That means the value of n is 5. Then I will be less than equal to n minus 1. That means 5 minus 1, 4. 4 times it will be go. So if you want to be calculate the runtime of a for loop by the help of this example, then we have to find the value of n here, determine the value of n. For example, if the value of n is 10, then this for loop will be continue till 9 times. Why? Because 10 minus 1 is equal to 9 and I loop will be less than or equal to 9. So it will be go till 9 times. At last it's mentioned this point, let running time of a basic operation is constant C and for loop is iterated n times, then the total runtime will be n into C. So by this formula we are able to be calculate the total runtime of a for loop. I hope it is clear for you now. Now here with the help of example I try to explain you about the primitive operations. So see here, I have int function I started. So here is a method as a function for us. So I equal to 0, a equal to 0, for again I have taken a for loop, print di, and a equal to a plus I, that is the incrementing value. That means each step the value of a will be incremented by one only, and return finally I. Now this can be explained by here itself. Primitive operation, yes and no. Total, assign a value to a variable. Here we can call the method, then arithmetical operation here perform, and then finally indexing into an array. Indexing into an array means what? So here the value of a equal to a plus 1 in the first step. The next step it will become a equal to a plus 1. That means each time it will be incremented by one value. So suppose here the value of a the first time is 3, then the next time it will become 3 plus 1, so that will become 4. Now here again it's a given summary about the primitive operation. Total, assign a value to a variable. Yes, we assign a value to a variable, that is 5. There in the last slide I have repeated again here. Call a method, we didn't call a method, so I have given no. Arithmetical operation performed, yes we performed arithmetical operation, and two operation, that is 1. Comparison two numbers, yes we have using for loop, so we are comparing. Sorry. Indexing into an array, so we are going to be indexing the array. That means it's in an array number of elements we have given, and each elements having the index value, so we are going to indexing the array number. Now we have see about the RASP. RASP stand for random access stored program machine. Random access stored program machine with our stored program model, we are going to be talk on this. So same as random access machine, but allow program to change itself as it is not stored in the memory. So random access machine, what? Allow the program to change itself which is stored in the memory. Same RASP can also allow us. So von Neumann architecture is one of the best example for the RASP, that is called random access stored program machine. Here is the diagram for the random access machine. Now stored program model or von Neumann model of a computer, so we can see here. So this model is given by the John von Neumann in 1944 to 1945. He proposed that program and data are logically same, so program also should store in the memory of a computer. So who proposed this? John von Neumann. So that this model name itself given as a von Neumann model of a computer. When this proposal was given in 1944 to 1945. What the statement he has given that time? He says that program and data both are logically same, so that both can be stored in the memory of a computer. So now in this same proposal, the second statement he has given that computers built on the von Neumann model divide the computer hardware part into four subsystems. That means according to the von Neumann model, computers hardware is divided into four subsystems. First one is called memory, second one is called arithmetical logical unit, third control unit, and fourth input output. And as this figure shows that this is called ALU, this is called control unit, memory, then input and output. So input, we are giving the instruction to the computer, then ALU and control unit, they are going to be control unit is accessing the input data. Now checking whether which type of instruction is there. If it is ALU, then ALU will do it, and then finally it will be come to the memory, and then from memory, if the output device is ready, then it will be go to the output part to display the desired output. Now a stored program concept. So how this STORE program works. What is the concept behind this? So von Neumann model states that program must be stored in memory. So this model states that program must be stored in the memory. Second point says that this is totally different from the architecture of early computer. Why? Because in early computer says that the data was stored in the memory. Here program was stored only in the memory, but early computer says that only the data was stored in the memory. There is a conflict. Early computer and the von Neumann model. So von Neumann model says that data and program both can be stored in the memory. But early computer says that no, only data can be stored in the memory. The memory of modern computer hosts both a program and its corresponding data. But finally, in modern computer, they both can be stored, program as well as corresponding data in the memory. This implies that both the data and program should have the same formats, but both they have the same format and they can be stored in the memory. In fact, now the boundary pattern is followed by the memory. So the boundary patterns is nothing but its 0 and 1s. So all should be stored into 0 and 1s. So our computer store any program or data in form of a boundary pattern that is nothing but its 0s and 1s. Now sequential execution of instruction. How this instruction sequential execution is working? A program in a von Neumann model is made up of a finite number of instructions. That means it's a fixed, finite. It's not an infinite. Infinite means jiski ant nahi hoti, but finite means it's a fixed number of instructions. In this model, the control unit feeds one instruction from the memory, decode it, and then execute it. That means it will fetch, that means will access from the memory, then decode it, and then execute it. So this can be done by the control unit. Of course, this sequential execution means it will be go in a sequence way. It doesn't mean that the control unit does not allow you to jump for the previous instruction. You may jump, but instruction should be followed in the sequential order only. Sequential execution of a program was initially requirement of a computer based on the von Neumann model. So it was first requirement given by the von Neumann model, and it's the initial requirement of the computer based, which is given by the von Neumann model. So today our computers execute program in order that is the most efficient, and that is called sequential execution of instruction. So today computers, what we are doing, it's in a sequence way. They are following the sequential execution of instruction. So today computer, we are using today, which following the sequential execution of instruction. That means one after another, it will be go in a sequence way. Then last, this slide, we are going to know about the difference between random access machine and random access memory. We already know about random access memory is a what? It's a permanent or temporary memory. It's a temporary memory. It's called a volatile memory, where the data can be not stored permanently. So it says that it's a primary memory in which CPU stores the data in a real life computer, but it's not a permanently. But random access machine is simplified model of a modern computer used in a theoretical computer science to analyze algorithm. That means if you want to study about, analyze about your algorithm in case of a time or in case of the space, then we are going to be use the random access machine to analyze our algorithm. So this is the simple basic diagram of the random access machine. So by the help of this machine, we are able to be analyze our any algorithm, whether our algorithm is effective or not. Dear students, I hope it is clear for you. Now this is the reference. I have given three reference. YouTube reference are there. If you can click it, you can get more idea. And one book I have given for you. You can just go through this book. It will be give more exposure about your this basic model of competition. So this is all about the basic model of competition. I hope it is clear for you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.